Good day, everybody. We're live with I Am The Data podcast focused on leadership and inner development. Happy to have everybody here that tunes in or see this thing later on in the future. We're here to talk about a topic that I see is moving around the world, and I think that's important. So I kept it short and sweet. The emerging you. Also put it on the ad, the new emerging you. Right, it's basically going about changes. If anybody haven't subscribed to IAMTHEDATA, I'm on YouTube, Instagram. I'm also on Spotify, Google Podcasts, Amazon Podcasts, iHeartRadio, and different stations as well. Always reach out to me and find out where I'm at. And we can also connect with you as well to be on a podcast. I got some exciting guests coming up in the next 2 weeks. This week I didn't have one. So, you know, the role, I just keep going. Sometimes I have guests, sometimes I don't. But today, you know, that's what it falls back on, is emerging in your own life, right? Sometimes we sit back and we wait, you know, for others to connect with us, you know, for others to give us opportunities or for us to be noticed in the room. But when we look at life, life comes about as far as you noticing yourself in real time and also in real purpose, and not waiting around for this magical moment that's actually going to take place. In essence, you are that magical moment that you're looking for. You know, it's defining the strength of you and looking at yourself through different lenses that you have created for yourself in the world. And how is it that you actually come about to make sure that you're always emerging, that you're always elevating from one level to the next, and that you don't stay stagnant in your approaches to life? You may feel that if you were to take a certain opportunity, it will actually stop you from moving in your direction, right? You want to be known for a particular thing. You want to show up for a particular reality. But how is it that you know all things about your path, and how do you know all things about your purpose? You know, life is a mystery to all of us in one degree or another. One man or one woman may have one gift, another has another, and so forth and so forth and so forth. This is why we go to plays, why we go to movies, you know, why we listen to entertainers, because people have gifts that we don't have. And some of the gifts that people have that we actually enjoy, these are gifts that came about later on in life. They might have started out as a fireman and it turned into a singer or turned into a dancer. You know, I run into somebody like Rick Ross that actually was a correction officer that actually came into an influential rapper, right? We're looking into this life and we're seeing that we're emerging. But it's something that goes with that emerge. It's basically the point of, will you step out of your own way? As you're evolving and as you're coming into new spaces in life, will you allow yourself to actually embrace that moment? Will you allow yourself to go along for the ride of your life, even though you don't know where it's going to take you? Will you do that for yourself? As you see yourself increasing in the world, as you see that old opportunities are falling away and new opportunities are actually striving to take its place, will you allow those things to fall away and allow new things to come into your life? New people, go to new places, experiences new realities, taste new foods, things of that nature. Read a new book or read something that's outside of your normal education to increase and to expand yourself to a whole nother genre. Are you so purposeful in your life that you allow yourself to know that you don't know, and that you really don't need to know all things, but you just need to have some inkling of where you're trying to go or what you're trying to do? But what happens when you don't? Are you strong enough to stand in your feet? Are you strong enough to stand in your hope and desires of the world? Do you have the right moral systems and value systems that's going to allow you to springboard into new spaces like IAMTHEDATA, right? IAMTHEDATA came about, you know, just me thinking about my life and me looking at it and saying, you know, I can take another approach to how I've been doing things, and I can put my life under a microscope and know what, you know, can I deal with the failure of it, it was to take place? But am I strong enough, I'm saying, to embrace opportunities that it may bring my way? And if opportunities come my way, will I make the necessary sacrifices in order to move forward? This world is, you know, mystical at some points. And, you know, you'll see a person on top this day, down the next, you know, a person on the bottom one day, on top the next, you know. And you just start to question things. Like, when will I emerge? When will I find, you know, myself like a needle in a haystack? You know, how deep will I search for my life? How deep will I search for my goals, my aspirations? Is everything that I do on the surface, is everything that I do is easily defined by me as well as others? And how do I make sure that I become the learning lesson for my life and not allow situations or so-called accomplishments be the reality of my existence? Let's say, for instance, you was to lose this job that you have that's actually allowing you to have this great lifestyle. Are you able to reemerge? Are you able to go into new territories in your mind and your spirit? Are you able to control your emotions to the point where I allow you to start crafting out a new master plan for yourself? Or will you just allow your life just to fall apart and you say, you know what? I did my best. I tried, you know, it just didn't work out. You know, I'm gonna just go and I'm gonna crawl under a rock. Right? So as we looking at to reemerge into the world, we have to understand that this is a gift to be able to shift. One of my friends said the other day online, you know, this is cool. She said, this is like my third life, you know? I'm living like my third life right now. You know, and I looked at that and said, you know what? It makes sense because we're always changing. We're always evolving. And we got to give ourselves the opportunity to change, the opportunity to evolve, to make mistakes, you know what I'm saying, to be successful, you know, to learn from the value of ourselves, from others, from the journeys that we have taken, from the journeys that we have not taken, those paths that we thought we were supposed to be on, but those paths move past us and we wind up on a whole nother path. To be able to be, what you would say, the gift of your life. What is the gift of your life, right? Do you want to sing, but you're scared to sing? Do you want to dance, but you don't think that people want to actually take you seriously? Are you an author, but you never picked up the pen, you know, to write the first word so you can move forward, right? Will you build systems that will benefit you and your legacy? Or will you continue to follow paths and dreams of others? You know, will you be a worker your whole life? Will you actually venture out to be an entrepreneur? Will you take the safe route? Or will you explore uncharted territories? This is what it comes about when you talk about the emerging you, right? Chipping at that old block that you've been using for your whole life, what you've been standing on as your foundation. We got a world right now where we got wars and things that's going on, and people are reemerging. People are finding out they have resilience, that they never knew that they had because they never was put to the test. They found out that they have insight about their life and about the world that now they can use to inspire themselves as well as others. They have found out that they have more love for their lives and more love for humanity than they could ever have imagined. And it's only through their trial and errors that they find this. It's only through their pain and their suffering that they've come to this deep understanding that I can do more things, that I can live a life that I have never imagined, and I can come out of strongholds that I never thought I would be able to. The emerging you, what is that? I'll tell you what it is, man. It's the spiritual gifts that you have that you've been allowing to lay dormant. It's that laughter, you know what I'm saying, that you have that deep inside you, but you're too afraid to bring it out. It's in the core, it's in the pit. And when you bring it out, and when you finally let it release, you know what I'm saying, you'll feel so much more value and more pleasure for your life. It's that insight, you know what I'm saying, that you know you have, but you don't want others to think that you don't know what you're talking about. So you won't take a chance and you won't take a risk. It's betting on yourself, you know, getting into investments, you know, learning how to save, you know, taking a chance, you know, stabbing the dark, you know, that you say, you know, it's not going to work out. You know, I can be doing, you know, I can be doing something else with my life. I can, you know, just be working or just, you know, take the safe route and allow my life to just be, you know, as basic and as casual as possible. You can challenge yourself. You can come out of spaces that you have been known for, that people only describe you as. And you can say, you know what, that's not me. You know, I used to be that person. You know, I used to be defined as this. I used to be defined as that. But I have taken on the notion that I no longer want to be this singular person, right? I want to have more for my life, more identities, more truths, more honors and respect. I want to bring integrity back into my life. I want to restore my relationships with others. I want to venture out into new territories because at the end of the day, I'm worth it. I'm worth all of it. That emerging you is actually tapping you on the shoulder. It's crying out to you to tell you, yo, man, you know, let's do more things. Let's explore. Let's live life on our terms, according to our value systems, according to our belief systems. Let's create a moral compass, saying that we can pay for us like a red carpet, you know what I mean? And just move throughout all the things that we want to do. So one day we won't have to say, you know what? I didn't do it. I was so afraid to live my life. I was so afraid to venture out into new things. You know, I was in control. I was controlled by others. You know, I'm in school and I hear a lot of people would say that the role that they used to play before they came to school are no longer the role that they're playing now. The role that they allow people to basically plan their lives, they have taken those roles from people and have actually allow themselves to be more responsible for their lives. They're no longer, you know, the puppet on the string. Now they see their lives on a whole different, you know, plateau. And they want to journey on this terrain. And they want to make sure that this terrain that they're journeying on now is filled with the things that they want out of life. That is encased in the way that they want to go. And it's not just about know what others want from me and how others want me to be or how they want me to live, but actually looking at life on their own terms, right? And saying, I don't know all things, and I may never know all things about this life, but I'm willing to take a chance on my life. I'm willing to explore and step outside the box, you know, fight for what I believe is right, make the necessary sacrifices that I have to make in order for me to stand true in my true form and love myself on a high level. Let's say the new you is emerging emotionally, where you have gone through emotional traumas. You know, you have gone through abandonment issues and things of that nature. You know, you had your heart broken and things of that nature. How to get that power back? How to start living in a way that you have never lived before? And how to trust yourself, even in the midst of failure, that you will be able to be successful. We speak about success, we speak about failure. We applaud success, we denounce failure. When we look at it and we're saying, you know what? All of us is transitioning, whether we have a lot or we have a little. An amazing thing is that we don't know when this space of transition is gonna take place, but we do know one thing is that it's gonna take place. And with that notion, this is what should inspire us. Knowing this, exploring ourselves, challenging ourselves, holding ourselves accountable to what we perceive ourselves to be in the world. You know, today I looked at on all the different journeys that I had with IAMTHEDATA. You know, I had many guests, and I had partnerships. You know, I done worked with other different teams to, you know, basically increase the podcast. And all this has come about because I have took a chance to actually create a podcast. And I have some days be like, you know what, I don't even know what I'm going to talk about. You know, I don't even know what people want to hear from what I got to say. I don't think people are going to support me any way I want to support me. My numbers are not growing in this way, or you know, this is not happening, or that's not happening. But I come to a realization that I'm happening. And that's all that matters. You know, those things will take place when it's time for those things to take place. But as long as I show up for me, as long as I make sure that I am the principal thing for the reason why I do this thing, it will be the reason why I continue to do this thing. I can continue to get lost in this reality or lost in that reality, or define myself according to this thing, according to that thing. But at the end of the day, I realized something too, that I'm not a thing. None of us are. We can accumulate things, you know, we can put them on our shelves, we can bring them in the house and say they're a couch or a bed, or, you know, we can go on a lot and buy a car, and this is all things that we have accumulated. And, you know, the value of a thing has no value because you're the value of the thing. You have to take care of those things. You have to put life into those things. You got to wash them, clean them, you know, cultivate them and things of that nature. And you have to fight to keep things in your life that you brought into your life to the point where it takes over your identity. How do you disassociate yourself to things to ensure that the major value for life will be you? That you're gonna be at peace, you're gonna create substance for yourself, you're gonna stand strong, and you're gonna do what you need to do and learn from the lessons that you need to learn from. I'm out here in the world. You know, I just heard a friend of mine's name Hope had passed away that I used to do advocacy with about 2 days ago. Blessings to Hope. A moment of silence to Hope. You know, and I met Hope when, you know, we was in Albany on the bus, you know, taking our little 2 hour trip, and we just had a conversation. And we talked about our different paths and actually what brought us on to be on that bus and what change that we want to make in the world by being on this bus. And when we get off the bus, who are we going to talk to? Why are we going to talk to them? How are we going to talk to them? Right? And it's all according to the emergent us. Right? We came together, you know, collectively, but got on that bus as individuals. And we got up to Albany, we talked, we split up in groups, you know, we took pictures, we ate together, you know, we drank together, you know what I'm saying? We had more conversations together. And when I heard that Hope passed away, a young woman, I said, wow, you know, this is a powerful thing. You know, because we see that life is a transitional state. And some of us, in a way, will tap into who we are on a higher level, and some of us will not. But either way it go, we don't know our fate. We don't know what our fate would do for us, where it would take us. We don't know the power of hope and the power of desire. And what those things are, and if we combine hope, faith, and desire into one entity, where would it take us? Yes, some of us has lost some invaluable steps in our lives. We have stepped on minefields. We have turned corners that we wasn't supposed to turn. We have said things that we wasn't supposed to say and actually stripped things away from us. When we look at it, the beauty of making a mistake or the beauty of success is all viewed in hindsight. They are not stamped, you know what I'm saying, in the universe. It's not saying because I was successful this day that I'm always going to be successful. Because I was a failure this day, I'm always going to be a failure. It's telling us that we have taken risks with our lives. We have stepped into spaces that we never thought we would step into. We have learned from who we're supposed to learn from, what we're supposed to learn. We have read the things that we had to read to move us forward. We have watched some videos and some tutorials and some study guides. And we have done some investments that allow us to turn around and purchase things that we never thought we'd be able to purchase. We have met women and men in the world that we say we never thought we would actually be able to meet these individuals, and they loved us and we loved them. We have brought children into the world. We have taken risks. And these risks that we have taken, oh, they're so powerful. Oh, they're beauty to who we are, right? And this is Maya. How you doing, Maya? Me and Maya had a conversation in the past, you know, and it was a great thing talking to Maya. And I also have a guest here, guys, and he's going to come in.
Hello, how you doing?
What's going on? This is Carmel. And anybody that want to know, this is my youngest son, Carmel.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Yes, sir. You know, and Carmel and I have been having some profound conversations for these last couple of weeks, you know. Not saying we never talked before, you know, that's my son. It's just that our conversations have taken to a new height.
Yeah, new level, new vibration, basically.
Yeah, new vibration, a new energy, and just, you know, valuing each other as men in the land and seeing each other, not just, you know, as that's my son, that's my dad, but seeing ourselves, you know, as this energy, you know, as this force, you know, and as these change agents that we are, right? So I invited Carmel to come on the show to just, like I said, have a conversation. And, yeah, you know, you can, Yeah, yeah. So the topic is the emerging you. So you might can basically expound on that a little bit on what you have been seeing as far as how you have emerged in the world.
And evolved spiritually.
Yeah, and how is it looking for you? And, you know, what are some of the things you may do to keep yourself in a high vibration? And what are some things like, you know what, I'm not even going to deal with that because it's going to mess up my vibration.
So it's like, you know, we've been talking about life a lot, I'm saying. So what I have learned, because before I was about 230 pounds, right? About 6 months ago, and I wanted to lose some weight. And everybody keep telling me, you know, strength training, you got to go to the gym, you got to work out, lift these weights and all that. But I stumbled across a lot of those platforms, and they was talking about the power of the fruits, you see? And the fruits hold so much power, I'm saying. So basically what I've been doing was, I started off slowly, I'm saying, because, you know, you got to take your time. And I started eating fruits every morning. I started juicing. I started going and diving into these smoothies. And I started cutting off on the meat. And then here I am, 6 months later, I'm about 160, you know what I'm saying? So it's like fruits are really the essence of life. And that's what gives us the source, because the Most High created the source. He created us too as well. I mean, he created the fruits for us to eat. I'm saying we eating animals, and the animals are supposed to be our friends. You know what I'm saying? So that's basically what I've been experiencing. And it's been a long journey, but it's been beautiful, you know, like. Every time when you eat a fruit, it's like you just feel so much life. But like, if you want to eat a piece of steak, does it give you that energy? I'm saying, do you feel connected to it? Do you feel connected spiritually? Do you feel anything you eat that piece of meat? I'm saying, that steak. So eat me as my soul. Sometimes I be indulging, you know, turkey and stuff like that. But I try to stay away from those things, I'm saying. Because, you know, it's hard because that's what I'm so used to eating. And now I'm just realizing that the fruits are the key to us being in a high vibration. And higher in our frequency and consciousness as well, I'm saying. So that's what it's about, man. So if you guys want to continue your future journey, you guys don't have to start as soon as possible. I mean, you guys don't have to rush into it, but I always say one fruit a day goes a long way. I'm saying so. That's basically my take on it.
Yeah, so, you know, we're looking at, and people might want to know what kind of fruits. I know we got our apples, oranges, bananas. Quamel is a fan of watermelon.
Yeah, watermelon. Yeah. I love you some watermelon, man.
Yeah, you love some watermelon, right? You know, and it's taking the time out to learn about your life and instilling core values in the essence of who you are, right? And some people might say, oh, no, I like steak, you know, I like this, but it's not really about liking steak or liking fruits and vegetables. Mm. It's about taking control of your existence.
That's it. That's key, for sure.
Right? Yeah, it's about, you know, saying, you know what, I'm worthy of losing 50 pounds because, you know, it's too much weight that I got to carry around.
Yeah.
You know? It's just, you know, I'm walking up, like, sometimes you go on the train station, it'd be like 50 steps you got to walk up.
You tired, you get to the first step.
You're tired.
You're hard and shit.
Yeah. Like, sometimes I go, because, you know, I got a lot of energy, so I'll just be pouncing up the stairs, but, you know, I'll be seeing other people, they go up halfway up the stairs, and they just stop, and they got to get a breather, and they're tired, they're exhausted. You know, and this life has so many challenges that you can't even fathom how many challenges you're gonna go through in life. But the one challenge you don't want this life to be is you. Like, you constantly don't want to be on a challenging end of your own life. You want to be free of certain things in your own life because you got to go out there, you got to challenge, you know, friends, strangers, lovers, all these different type of things that's out here. With your bosses and you know the economy, all these different things that's going on right now, and it's like even with we're talking about the Israeli-Hamas war, you know, it came from Israel. Now it's in New York, right? Mm-hmm. So now if you go into Manhattan, to walk down a block, you're gonna see, you know, signs on a pole saying people got kidnapped. You know, you're gonna see people, you know, taking out their own vengeance in the world. And it's because we believe in the way that, you know, we're controlled by all the things that take place around us.
Exactly.
Instead of us having control and having dominance of our own lives, we allow these external circumstances to actually dominate our internal realities, our internal pathways that's in the world. Like, for instance, you know, say, oh, this is my son, so I'm supposed to, like, take charge of his life and control his existence. But when we're looking at life, we see that life comes with a component called free will.
That is true.
Yeah. Yeah. Like, we can't get around the reality of free will. So because free will exists, what do I have control over in the universe?
Nothing.
Nothing.
You have control over you. And sometimes, like you was reaching on that the other day, sometimes you don't have control over your own life. You know what I'm saying? So in retrospect, you have control over nothing.
That's right. Yeah, you just have to be able to, when they, you know, to be according to your being, right? And sometimes it's going to take you for the ride of your life, and then sometimes it's going to allow you to chill and relax. You know, it's a scripture in the Bible where the Most High says, you know, remember the good times because they're few, right?
That's the thing with what us two does as well. We don't never embrace the bad times. I'm saying, it's like, I was talking to my friend the other day, and I was telling him, like, you know, everybody got this reality, like, everything supposed to go good and supposed to be happy every time. You also have to embrace the bad time because it's a balance. It's negative and positive energies, I'm saying? So to get to the good, you have to go through the trials and tribulations and have to go through the bad things, I'm saying? But people don't want to embrace the negativity, and that's why they always get trapped in it and engulfed in it, I'm saying? Because they don't know how to handle when things go amiss because they think things are always supposed to be positive.
Yeah, I mean, you get caught up in an illusion where you know you watch TV, you know, like, got your favorite show where they doing laughter and things of that nature,
yeah.
And everything just comes out perfect, right?
Because it's like a fantasy. It's television.
Yeah. It's a fantasy, but you know, you're see, that's the whole thing, and this is the reality of it. Your mind doesn't know the difference between reality and fantasy. If you constantly feed the mind something, it's gonna believe it.
It's gonna believe like this is just, this is life.
That's correct. If you go under a household and they got some basically dysfunctional values in that household, and they teaching those values to their children, when their children get older, they're gonna
think it's normal.
Some of those values, they're gonna think it's normal. They're gonna mimic some of those value systems, and then you might say, like, I read this something the other day that I came across, but it was just so amazing. It was a woman, she was raising her son from a little kid. And from a little kid, she would always tell him, when he cried, men are not supposed to cry. Men are not supposed to cry. Stop crying. Men are not supposed to cry. So he, after a while, he basically took on that notion that he's not supposed to cry, which means that he's not supposed to get in touch with his emotional intelligence. That's basically what she did. She robbed him of his emotional intelligence. So now when he become a teenager, she comes to speak to him about certain things that's supposed to actually have emotional intelligence response, but he has no response to her now.
He doesn't have that son.
Okay. And she says, why are you always so quiet? Why don't you open up? Why don't you express yourself on a higher level? And he just looking at her like he was looking at her when he was a young kid and was like, I don't got nothing to say.
Yeah.
Right? So we all control a lot of time our external environments, and we don't see what their control actually does to us 5, 10, 15, 20, 30 years from now, because a lot of us are not long-range thinkers. As you and I were talking about the other day, we're only thinking for the moment. What you have today, you automatically perceive that you will have tomorrow. That's how... This is how the human species actually work.
And that is true. That's how they think.
Yeah.
They don't think for the future. Everybody lives in a moment, and they live into these fantasies. Like you said, every day brings a new life. I'm saying?
Every day.
Evolving, and you don't know what your life might bring tomorrow. I'm saying? Because you're not there to see it. We here right now. So tomorrow, you don't know what's going to happen around 8, 9 o'clock. I'm saying?
You don't know. I read a story about a football player probably like 6 months ago. So the football player, he had got a divorce from his wife. Mm-hmm. And he had money. You know, he said, you know, he had money and stuff like that. He had agents, he had lawyers. So he had some things that was mapped out. So he's figured out, you know, I got a divorce from my wife. Let me move out the house, right? And I'm going to rent an Airbnb.
Okay. Right?
And I'm going to stay in the Airbnb for like a month. And I'm going to transition from the Airbnb and get another house. Unbeknownst to him, that he was going to run into an opposition in the Airbnb.
Mm.
He got into an argument with a man, and the man took his life, and he never got to the Airbnb.
Wow.
Even though he had the money, he had the plan, he had the insight.
Well, Everything was perfectly mapped out,
except that he didn't foresee the man that was already in the Airbnb, or he's going to run into an Airbnb, because unfortunately, you know what I'm saying, we can't tell the future.
Exactly.
Right? So,
it's real deep, man. It's deep, man. It's deeper than you guys think, you know, so.
Yeah, it's really deeper than, you know, and whoever popped in, you know, excellent point about illusions and men emotional intelligence. Yes, you know, we have to be purposeful in our lives, but only to a certain extent that we try to make sure that we craft out the full reality of our lives. Like, we have to give ourselves breathing room in a space where if we were to make a mistake, we can pivot from that mistake. And if we were to become successful, we do not get engulfed in the success. Yeah, like, you know, once you become successful, all of a sudden you believe that you can harm men, you can harm women. You can start doing all type of crappy things in the world, you know what I'm saying? Because you're successful, you're basically like the Untouchables, right? The Untouchables was a movie, and all those men got touched, right? So even though they made a call to the movie The Untouchable, none of those men came out alive.
Yeah.
But you know what I'm saying?
You know what it is, though, is people don't see the lessons and things that they watch. I'm saying they'll take one part and run with it. You see how, like you said, when they get rich, the Untouchables wasn't able to be touched. But they don't see at the end that these guys have actually lost their lives because they thought they had control over life and they thought they was gonna be untouchable. I'm saying, so it's a reality of thing. We have to pay close attention to details. Some of us don't actually pay attention and listen to the universe and things that's happening around us, listen to these life lessons that these movies and these experiences that we're going through. We have to actually listen to the land. I'm saying, listen to the universe.
Yeah, because we're not the only vessels that experience life, right? We are here now, but there were life forces here before us. That's why we can watch a movie from the 1600s, right? We can look at the betray of times that we wasn't even in existence, and then try to correlate it to our own existence, or try to identify, or even try to bring judgment to it. But we wasn't there. We wasn't in that time. It's like even when you go into the Bible and it talks about a time period where men and women lived in a certain way. And we say we're supposed to live like that. And we were like, well, you know, that time is not here anymore. We have transitioned from that time. So when we become successful or we so-called fall into a space of failure, we do not move ourselves out of that time. We keep ourselves locked in. Like, I always got to be successful. I'm always going to be a failure. This thing is always going to follow me and travel around with me in life. And by doing this, we do life a disservice, because life is connected to life itself. It's not connected to you.
Mm-hmm.
Right, you think that you have power over life, but you don't have power over life, and life doesn't have power over you, because this is a dual relationship, right? We're transitioning, we're moving at the same time.
That's true.
And what's happening to you in life is also have a different reality for somebody else that's in life.
Mm-hmm.
So it can be like, for instance, it's 50 of us in a room. And some type of chaos take place. Not every person in the room is going to respond the same. Some men are going to get quiet, you know, some people are going to hide.
Some people are going to be running
out the door, right? You know what I'm saying? You don't know what a person is going to do until that time come. And the person that you may think is going to do something totally different may surprise you and do the opposite. Right? Because we're not the authors of life that we perceive ourselves to be. It's an article I read about Steve Jobs. You know, so everybody knows who Steve Jobs is, right? You know,
yeah,
the Apple tycoon, and you know, he made multi-billion dollars, and every computer that he made is in people's household. I got a MacBook right now.
Yeah, me too.
Right? So it's like Steve Jobs, like, thanks for the MacBook, right? Type of situation. And he was just living this life that he was living. You know, he was challenging the SEC. He was challenging DMV. He challenged every single system that he came across because he didn't want to be subjected to no type of system. So he challenged every system, system of man, the system of woman. If he could have challenged the air, he would have challenged that too.
Right? Yeah.
So, you know, see, Jobs wound up, you know, passing away from cancer. And his daughter, she was at his bedside, and she had basically did an interview after his passing. And she said, you know, he believed that he had everything in life. So because he had all these different trinkets and all these different gifts, you know, you would think that his transition would be so beautiful and so peaceful.
Mm.
You know, it would be an odd. Everybody would want to pass away and transition like him. But his daughter said on his deathbed, y'all can look this up, he saw something.
Mm.
He saw something that startled him. It rocked him to the core. And whatever he saw while he was transitioning, he just kept saying, oh, wow, oh, wow, oh, wow. Because he couldn't believe what he saw. And she didn't know what he saw. But whatever he saw, it was greater than what he's seen in this plane. It was greater than what he perceived that life is just supposed to be, this one type of entity.
And it changes his whole perspective on life.
Yeah, but now he can't do anything about it because on this plane, his time has expired, and now he's moving into a whole other transition. And what does that transition look like as you're moving forth? Right? I've sent you some earlier where the woman was talking about, she was talking about our spiritual paths.
Okay.
And she said something interesting. She said that, most of the people that we run across, they have a spiritual lesson to teach us, some type of spiritual gift, whether it may be on the train, the bus, whatever. But because we don't interact, we don't share these different things in the world. She said, mm-hmm. When you have friends and your friends harm you, right? She said, those friends that harm you on this plane are actually your best friends on the spiritual plane. She said that you made a pact with these friends when you was on a spiritual plane to basically uproot you from comfortabilities, to ensure that you do not get fixated on the physical plane, to ensure that when you transition, you would transition on a high spiritual plane.
Wow.
And you agreed to this relationship. You agreed to getting robbed by your best friend, you know what I'm saying? Or your best friend, you know what I'm saying, messing with something that you love in the world, like a woman and things of that nature. You agree to these things because you need to be able to move away from these certain realities that hold you captive in the land. We come in the world and we become captive to situations. And we don't know how to pivot because these things are only things that we identify with. But once they get snatched from us, or once we get betrayed by something or somebody, or once we experience some type of heartfelt pain, what happens to us?
Now we start looking for something more spiritual.
That's right. Now
we start meditating. Now we start wanting to live a better life because, you know, we have been harmed, and somebody close to us has harmed them. So now we're seeking spiritual awakeness. I'm saying. So
that's
believe that sounds accurate for sure.
Yeah. He said these are your friends, right? I remember I had a dream not too long ago, and I hardly dream. But I had this dream as a friend of mine that had passed away. And I was in this dream and I saw him. And it was like he was there. It was like we was in a real form together. Like we was here, right? You know? And I'm in this dream and I seen him. And I got so excited. That's how I remember, because I got so excited when I saw him, because I ain't seen him in a long time. And when I went to embrace him, when I hugged him, he did not hug me back. And then another entity that came from behind him pulled me out of his grasp and took me to like a bar. And me and the person sat down at a bar. I didn't know who the person is, but I was very familiar with the person. And we sat there and we had a deep conversation. And then I woke up, right? And when I woke up, I was so perplexed, because I was like, this was my friend on this plane, right? But when I saw him on this spiritual cortex that I was introduced to, he didn't embrace me. And I was so bewildered behind that. And I was like, did he not embrace me because I'm not doing what I'm supposed to do on my spiritual path?
That could be it.
Right? You know, and I was just thinking, like, you know, or did he not embrace me because he's no longer here on this spiritual path and he wasn't able to fulfill his spiritual obligations, but I'm still here and it's some form of type of resistance against us, right? But I would never know that answer, right? But what I do know is that I did experience this, not in the real time that we see on this plane, but I saw it on another plane that actually shows me that this other plane does exist. And this was a friend of mine, a close friend of mine. Right. I used to say hard things to him when he was alive. Like, you know what I'm saying? Like, I used to say things to him that he didn't like. You know what I'm saying? But, you know, I consider him to be a friend, you know, and not being embraced by him really was disturbing to me for a little while. Like, I really had to, like, meditate on that, you know, sit back and relax, you know, put my life through a microscope and start looking at certain things. But then I was like, but who was the woman? Because there's a woman. Who was the woman?
Yeah.
I'm like, yo, who pulled me? Who pulled with me? And then had this, took me away from that vibration and brought me to a whole nother vibration and brought me comfort.
Mm.
Right? I experienced a spiritual comfort when that person pulled me out of his grasp. Right? And I still feel that comfort to today. Right? Which shows that in my transition, if I do the things that I'm supposed to do, I will also run into this embrace again on that next plane. And it's just learning that, you know, we have spiritual connections. We have connections with others that's not of this structure that we're on, because we're not here to be here forever. If that was the case,
A lot of us think that this is the only plane right here.
Yeah.
So a lot of us we are trapped in the physical world because, you know, all the money, all the cars, all the different things that's transpiring around us. They don't know that there's other universes and other dimensions and other spiritual planes that we are also connected to. And we also have friends on those levels as well. You know what I'm saying?
Yeah, because all the things that we desire, I mean, that's before you came on, all those things that we bring into our lives, we created them. We may think, because I didn't physically create them, it doesn't matter if I physically created them or not. We, as humanity, people, created these things. So if you created, I created too, because I also have the ability to create, right? But you didn't create it for you, you created it for me. You didn't make a polo shirt and then went into the store and bought it.
No, you made a polo shirt for us to buy.
That's right.
You made a car for everybody to drive a car. Everybody
that's right. Car. So. That's right. You might not even drive the car that you made. You might not even wear the clothing that you made, right? The hat that you made or the jewelry that you made. You may never explore it, right? Because you're going to go buy something that somebody else made. because you made these things because somebody else has something out there that you want and that you need. Mm-hmm. So you made this thing, you made yourself successful. And so instead of you living in your hotel, you go visit somebody else's hotel, right? Everything that's created by man is created by man, regardless of what he thinks or not. It's all created by man. If we create things in a righteous form and a righteous spirit, then men will benefit from the things that you create. If we do not, then men will suffer from the things you create. It's basically like one of my platforms that I was at, I think I was like one of the last speeches that I did. Mm-hmm. And in front of Farley Square, they never asked me to come back out and speak again from that last speech that I had. Yeah, yeah. They never hit my phone again and asked me if I wanted to speak again.
That's bad.
never.
Right? You might get too much, man.
Yeah.
That's funny.
So the thing was that when I was doing this speech, you know, because I never really write out what I'm going to say when I do these speeches. They come to me spiritually. You know, I feel the vibrations. I feel the energy.
You just know what to say.
My spirit just takes over. I don't come with no plan. You know, like I'm not here to undermine men or to belittle men and women in their path. My spirit takes over and I speak what it tells me to speak. And this speech, I said, you know, we have created all these systems, you know, regardless of what system we have created. It might be your prison system, your welfare system, your economical systems. And all these systems that we created, do we take note that we will not live for 1,000 years?
Mm.
When we create these systems, do we say, what would the next 10 generations, the next 10 centuries of people benefit or be harmed by this creation? We don't do it. We're creating things in real time and in real form, and we're not thinking about the next 10 generations or the next 10 centuries of people that must and will come after us. There is no question about it. Whether you're here or not, it doesn't matter.
Life
is going to continue to go. If you're creating deadly systems in the world so you can live, you know, this grandiose life, right? Understand that those systems that you're creating will also follow you on your next transition. And they're looking at me and they're like, what is Nathaniel talking about?
Yeah.
Is Nathaniel out of his mind?
Yeah.
Right? And I'm sitting here and I'm like, you know, I'm standing, I'm talking, and I can feel it because there's police there, there's politicians there, it's all type of advocates there. And I'm telling them, listen, man. Whatever system that we create, we need to make sure that they're going to benefit the people 1,000 years from now, 2,000 years from now, 3,000 years from now. Don't get to the point where you're selfish with your existence, that you're going to create systems of harm that's going to harm people when you're no longer here, so you can live this more mediocre life that we're living here of 100 years, right? You may hear one woman live to 102, 110, 112, but you have never heard someone live for 150 years on this plane right here. You might go into the Bible. You go in the Bible and say somebody lived for 1,000 years or 900 years. But according to the last probably like five centuries, people have been dying 100 years or less.
And then remember how we had a conversation yesterday. And you was talking about, all right, so these people created these systems, but also they might be safe from the system, but what about your kids? What about your grandkids? What about their kids? So now, they offspring get trapped in the system. Now they're trying to figure out, why has this happened to me? You know what I'm saying? Why has this happened to my kid or my grandkid? You know what I'm saying? You cause harm against others, harm will come against your legacies as well. You know what I'm saying?
All right, because it talks about in the Bible, the Most High says, I will visit the iniquity of the fathers upon the children into the third and fourth generation of those mm-hmm. that hate me. This is what he says, right? It's right here in scriptures, right? And we're reading these Bibles. We're Catholics, Protestants, Jehovah's Witness, Hebrews, all the whatever terminology that we're using. We're picking up these Bibles and we're reading these things in the Bible, but we're conveniently skipping over certain passages that's actually supposed to put us in alignment.
For fact.
The Most High say he's going to visit your legacy. That's letting you know that these are generational things. These are things that's going to follow us for centuries. That the Most High son is. So listen, man, you think you play hardball? You don't know what hardball is, man. Listen, bro, I'm coming when you go when you transition and go to sleep. I still remember what you've done. You still got sons and daughters and grandsons and granddaughters and all these different things in the land, bro. I'm still coming through to bring for that retribution. Mm. Are we thinking that far? We're not thinking that far, right? As we emerge in life, you know what I'm saying, according to this topic, right, we need to understand that emergence has to be in alignment with not just this plane, but also on our transitional planes as well. That the beauty of life that we create on this plane will also follow us on the next plane as well. Why would you want to be in a spirit of unrest? Because this is basically what happens, you know what I'm saying, when we're not in connection with life itself, because life continues, and because it continues, it doesn't forget anything. We call it karma. Right, we may call it deja vu,
or whatever, right? You might call it. Yeah.
You may say, "Oh, I had a vision." Whatever floats your boat. You know what I'm saying?
It has many names, man.
It has many names to it, and some of the names we don't even know. But we do know this, man. Right, that life continues. Every day, somebody is being born in the world. A new life force is being born into the world. It could be an ant. It could be a butterfly, right? Yeah. It's a new life force. It's an animal. It could be a flower. You know what I'm saying? A new tree might spurt out the ground because its roots finally bear root, and now it can come out. And 100 years from now, somebody gonna say that tree right there is 100 years old, but I won't see it, right? But it's gonna be here nevertheless, right? A new man, a new woman is gonna come into the world. Right? And it's something that we cannot deny. It's something that we cannot change no matter what we try to do. And if that is the case, you know, we're talking hypotheticals and things of that nature. If that is the case, then the things that you plant in the world, will they not still sprout up 200 years from now?
For sure will.
Yes. Yes. They will. I'm going to share something, man. You know, I did a lot of advocacy. I've done a lot of different engagements dealing with humanity. You know, I'm a humanitarian. This is who I am, right? And I remember that I went to Rikers Island one year. And I'm on this podium. I got these greens on or whatever garment they had on my ancestors from like the early 1900s or something like that. I had a chain, had chains on my hand, chains on my feet. I had the symbol on my chest, you know, the numbers. They've been using these number systems to identify men like they branding cattle, yep. Right? And I'm on this podium, and I'm standing there at first, like, you know, it's like at first it's like a form of entertainment, right? We're just entertaining the world. And as I'm standing there, a spirit came over me. It's kind of like something just washed over me, like, whoa, right? And when it washed over me, I said, oh, I felt it. Mm-hmm. It was undeniable. It locked me into place. So now I'm like, I'm focused, and I'm just, it's not me, but it's me. You know what I'm saying? But it's like, I'm just focused, and it's this guy, it's the photographer, this white man, he's taking pictures of me. Like, da-da-da. And he stopped. He kind of like froze.
Yeah.
As he's taking pictures of me because he's seen something through his camera and I don't know what he saw. But he froze and he put the camera down and he just stared at me mad hard. And I'm standing there and I'm looking at him and the spirit said, and I'm not going to make it up, it said, if he could take your life right now, he would.
Mm.
And that's when I realized something, that this advocacy thing that I was doing was not a game. I realized that it has spiritual consequences to it. You know what I'm saying? And that men and women have also transitioned in this form. They also went out to advocate for the lives of other people and never made it back home because of the retributions that came against them when they was out there fighting for the freedom of life and things of that nature. And that's when I knew that, you know, I'm not gonna play with this. You know, I'm not gonna sit here and think that, you know, this is about a paycheck or this is about this or this is about that. This is about evolution, bro. This is about life itself. Right? And I just looked and seen, you know, this man, and he was perplexed. He was, whatever he saw, I didn't see it. But he never took his eyes off of me. I didn't even see him pick his camera up again to take any more pictures either. Hmm. Because whatever he saw got his undivided attention, right? And it just to show how, you know, the energies of who we are and who we used to be, right, still continue, and who our ancestors stuff used to be, it still continues in the world. And if we do not cultivate this gift of life, that life abides and our life continues, is one thing I see, that we're going to continue to create systems, detrimental systems, that will harm life even after we're gone. And we think that, you know, we escape because we, you know, we didn't. Yeah, we're here no more. We wasn't punished. You know, we didn't go to jail for it, or, you know, no man bring any harm to it because of the things that we've done. But just imagine for a moment, you know, just close your eyes and meditate and imagine for one moment that the harm that you've done in the world will find you 200 years from now. How would you respond in your existence at this time? And what would you do different if you knew without a shadow of a doubt that it will find you when you transition? How would you respond? What do you think?
That's deep.
What do you think about that?
I feel like that's deep. I feel like a lot of people, they might respond as if, like, they don't know why this happened to them. It's like we was talking about this, like, the surprise attack, you know? And it's where, like, you... Like, they created harm 200 years ago, so they have no knowledge because they're not self-aware of what's going on in their surroundings. So they have no knowledge when something happens to them 200 years later that they caused strife in the land 200 years ago. You know what I'm saying? So basically, they would just be on some things like, why is this happening? What have I done to deserve this punishment? You know what I'm saying? Because we have to also practice self-awareness. You know what I'm saying? We have to be aware of what's going on, be aware of the things that we create in the land, because it's also going to affect others. I'm saying a lot of people don't have that. So like you was telling me about your friend and his son had passed away. I'm saying, so yeah, when he came to you, he told you his son had passed away, but he forgot the harm that he caused before in the land. And also he didn't understand the lesson that life was teaching him at that time. So even if harm does come to you or your family, you also have to understand these lessons. Like, oh, you have to reflect on the things you have done. A lot of times we don't reflect on things and it's going to happen again because you haven't learned from the lesson that the Most High is trying to teach you. See?
That's right. I'm talking to some legislators and we going through this certain bill. I won't say what the bill is, but you know, we're talking about these certain bill and things of that nature. And I hear the basic genre that they're speaking, and it's just so casual and it's just so lackadaisical in a sense. And I would say things like, you know, guys, you know, you're like realizing something. And they say, what are you talking about? I say, well, you know, you think you're creating this bill for you, but you're not. You're creating these bills for others. It's other people that's going to be affected by this bill, other people that's being affected because this bill is not in place. And once you create this bill and put this bill in place, it is designed to preserve life. It is not just a piece of paper, right? It is a spiritual presence that's actually taking place in the land. It is a commandment that's telling man, now that you know, you know. So now you are held accountable when you read the book of Ezekiel, when it tells you that if you see a man doing wickedness and you do not forewarn him, and he was basically be demised because of it, that his blood is going to be on your hands. But he said, if you tell him and the same fate befalls him, that you're free, you know what I'm saying, of that retribution. So if his blood is going to be on your hands and he already passed away, then how would his blood be on your hands if he's no longer here? And if there's no retribution, then why would a concept of retribution take place if there should be no retribution after one transpires, after one transitions? Because there is one, right? And it's just learning, you know, as we're transitioning in life, and as my son be talking about, you know, I'm meditating, I'm fasting, I'm doing yoga, you know, I'm eating good food. It's opened up other propensities that's within his core that he doesn't understand. And some of these propensities may scare him.
For sure.
Some of these things may say, yo, be sure you want to go this deep? Like, you sure you don't want to just, like, stay on a nice, comfortable playing field? Or do you want to venture out past, you know what I mean, your point of comfortability? Do you really want to go into this space of the unknown?
And it's deep, Dad. I was just watching, I think, Joaquin Awakening, and he was talking about the power of the fruit. And he was saying how he went on a 90-day orange fast. And he said, I guess he said his body was so energetic that it kept coming out of his body. Like, he kind of actually projected, you know what I'm saying? And he said he went to this unknown place, and some things transpired and it scared him. So to piggyback off what you're saying, it's like you have to be ready for these things, you know what I'm saying? Especially like me, I'm going into the fruits, you know, fruitarian, things like of that nature. And these fruits are actually as old as us, and they have lessons and life experience too, because they are living things. We don't understand that these fruits and these plants and these trees, they live in, you know what I'm saying? So they have life lessons and experience to teach us as well. So you eating these fruits, you're going to experience certain things that is beyond your control. You see?
Yeah, I mean, because now I look at it, and this is because I never really thought about it until you said that.
Mm-hmm.
But when you go to a banana tree, or you go to an orange tree or apple tree, how many times have you seen the fruit that's attached to the branch rotten?
Never.
It's, and that's amazing, because now
that is amazing.
You see,
I never thought about that. That is amazing, though.
It just confirmed that it's life, because it's on the branches, right? It's in the elements, right? But as long as it's attached to the branch, it's a life force, right? And it continues to be nurtured as long as it's on the branch. But once you snatch it off the branch and put it in a bag and ship it overseas and put it in your people's supermarket, now's the expiration date on it.
Because you took that from life.
You took the life of it. You took the life of it, right? And now you want to consume it later on, right? And but that life is not really, it's not really in essence, you know what I'm saying? Like, it don't have its full capacity, because it had to go through all these different transitional stages before you got to it.
Just for you to eat it, yeah.
That's right. But if you went and plucked it straight off the tree and ate it right there,
yeah,
You have a whole nother life force of that fruit that you can't even imagine. And so it's things, even when we say that we're vegetarian, things like that, we got to realize that a true form of vegetarianism is actually to actually have the fruit at that particular time or for that plant. And this is something that they did not give us. This is something that's been basically robbed from us. You know what I'm saying? Even when if you go to farmer's market and things of that nature, right? They already had the fruits snatched off the plant. They, like, you go to the farm and they pull the fruit right there from the farm and give it to you, right? They take the fruit, they clean it up, they package it up, and they come and sell it to you. But they don't sell it to you in real time and in real spirit. So you can actually know what it feels like to have the true propensity of what that fruit is.
Essence of that fruit.
Yeah, we don't get the true essence of that fruit. It's just like a rose. A rose smells beautiful. And as long as you keep it in its root, you can benefit from it. But as soon as you pluck the rose up, it's going to be gone in like 2 days.
It does.
It's gone for like 3 days. That's right. It expires. Because we're not understanding that the earth is life. What's connected to the earth is life. What's connected to the trees. And as it's still connected, it is still life.
Everything is life.
And everything is life. And we're life as well. And we continue and we continue and we continue. And we don't understand that the things that we also put into the world, they also continue. Even when we're not here. Right? It was a story that I watched, this documentary. And it was a true story. It was a woman that was rich. She had two sons.
Okay.
And one of her sons actually went out from under her arm, you know, and ventured out into the world, right? And she was very domineering because she had money. So everybody had to do what she wanted them to do, right? And she always like, you know, if you don't do this, you know, I'm not going to give you none of my money when I pass away and things of that nature. But one of the sons was like, you know what? I want to live, man. You know, I want a wife. I want to have children. You know, I want to venture out on my own, you know? So she took an offense to that he wanted to live his life. But she had one son that was like, he was connected to the money. He didn't want to have nothing to do with life. You know, his whole life was her. So he took care of her. He was always around her. He followed her guidance and things of that nature. And lo and behold, she passed away. So when both of the sons came, you know, to the well, you know, the reading of the well or whatever. And to the oldest son's dismay, she didn't leave him one red cent.
Wow.
She gave all her money to the son that stayed with her, right? But the man that left, he went and created a family, which is her legacy. He went and created sons and daughters and stuff like that. And she didn't even see the extension of her life in the form of sons and daughters, you know what I'm saying, grandchildren. And the other man had no sons, no daughters, no wife, no responsibilities. And she gave everything to him. And the oldest son, he was taken aback. So he went to his brother and was like, yo, man, you know, what mom did was unjust. You know, I got a family, you know, I'm trying to live on a higher plane with my family. I'm trying to do things with my children, things of that nature. And the man was like, you know, if she wanted you to have something, she would have gave it to you. And, you know, to make a long story short, the older brother wound up taking a life of the younger brother.
Wow.
So now nobody has it. So, you know, and it would just show, like, even though she left a harmful harm in the earth. She left a curse in the land. And that curse came against both of her sons, not just one of her sons. Both of her sons basically paid the price of what she did in the land. So we got to look at it. You think that what you did is over and over said and done when you move on, but it's not. And stories like that shows you that what you do in the land does have consequences on the back end. People do remember the harm you've done in the land. If you harm my mother or my sister and things of that nature, they do remember these certain things. And you want to pay the consequence for those things, even though these people are not here. And when I looked at that story, I said, well, that was unjust for her to do such a thing.
That was unjust for her to do that.
Against her son, you know what I'm saying? And she did it against both of the sons because now she pit the two men against each other when they was never at odds with each other. They never had any issues with each other until she came and made a division
between
the two sons with the economics. And it turned out to be an ugly reality, you know, and you know, she might, you know, people might think, oh, well, she got away unscathed, you know, she went to her resting place and she's chilling, but that's not true.
She has no legacy.
There you go.
They both were destroyed.
They both were destroyed. And over something that man has made. You know, I said something the other day, and we got like 15 minutes left, but because I extended to another half an hour, but I said something the other day that made sense, and it just came to me out of nowhere. I was talking to my daughter, my youngest daughter, and something came across me. I said, you know, I see people worshiping money. I said, you know, women, men, and everything, they worship money. They're making it seem like it's just this big, grandiose thing. I said, but you know what? There's something I've never seen. And I've been here, you know, over 50 years. I said, I've never seen a woman's face on the money.
Mm.
I said, so the woman is worshiping the money. She's running behind the money. She's saying, I'm independent. I don't need nothing from nobody. But her face is not on none of those bills. She's not on a quarter, nickel, dime, penny. None of the paper money, right? But we say that woman is powerful, right? Women are a powerful entity and a strong entity in the world. But is she honored in the world in a sense where her name is on, her face is on the money, right? It's not. And even when I looked at the money further, I said, well, all the men that's on the money are not even alive.
They're not. They're all dead.
All of them. Every last one of them, we're alive, and we're basically dealing with men that's on the money, that's not here, and we're saying that it's the essence of life, but none of these men are here as the essence of life. So we're looking at systems and how we created these different systems, and they're not in alignment with life as it continues. These systems stay stay in the past. They, you know what I'm saying? They're dogmatic principles and concepts that don't shift, you know what I'm saying, with the new spirit of life.
They don't transition. Like, nope.
They don't transition. Christ said it would make no sense to put an old patch on a new garment.
Mm.
Why would you take an old patch and put on a new garment? It's going to stand out. It's not going to look good. Right, and we're talking about a man that was alive, they say, 2,000 years ago, and he's talking about this parable. He's giving you this concept of moving in real time and transition according to real things in life and according to true spirit, and not getting trapped in the past. We get trapped in our past about I used to be in this relationship and this happened to me and that happened to me and all these, you know, I used to own this and I used to own that, and now I don't have this, I don't have that. We get caught into a space that no longer exists. It has expired. It no longer has a value to it. The principles, you're looking at colonial times, and your men that's on the money, most of them was in colonial times, they are no longer in existence, even though they might have done some great things in their time period, but their time period is no more.
But we still worship them as they are here.
That's right, and we still worship them as they are here, and we make them a principle of our lives, right? We'll take a car, and we'll basically go against another man for a car and say that his life is not as valuable as the car, but the car is only bits of plastic,
copper,
metal, copper, you know, glass, cushion, plastic, all put together. And then it makes something. But if it was an individual, if you had a pile of glass and copper and everything, and you'll say, you know, would you take a man's life for that? You'd be like, no, because it doesn't have any value. But I come and I put it together and all of a sudden it has value, right? So we have to look at these different things that we're placing above our lives to make it seem like our lives are meaningless according to this or according to that, right? And I just see how we're not moving in real time as far as how we are supposed to emerge into the world. And some of the things that we're supposed to bring into the world are supposed to be of light. The things that we bring into, we are born into light to bring forth light, because we are light. There's no other analogy, you know what I'm saying, that I see, you know what I'm saying? Because we're light, we're responsible for life, and we're responsible to bring forth life and to channel new life into the world, you know what I'm saying, and bring forth new expressions of creativity, awareness, purpose, wisdom, right, longevity into life itself, right? Because this is what we do. We bring forth life. When you go into a church or you go into a mosque, what are they talking about? They talk about life.
Life.
That's all they're talking about. You can say they talked about this scripture or they talk about this scripture. It doesn't matter what scripture they're talking about. They're only talking about life. When they pass around that bin and say, put your money in here, that money represents what? Life.
It's going towards life.
It's going towards life. Somebody gonna buy a piece of bread with it, the food, cheese, the food, milk, the potatoes,
everything.
That's right. A house, new windows, some new teeth. They're gonna go to Cuba and get some new teeth, right? This is all pertaining to life itself.
To life.
Every single thing that we do on this plane, every single thing that we do on this plane is a representation of life itself. Anything that's outside of life itself has no value to us as a people. Whatever thing that we create and it's not created in the presence or in the spirit of life, then it should not be created.
That is true.
Yeah, because what is the lesson of something? What's the lesson of a chair if nobody can sit in it?
It has no value.
If I make a table, but no one can sit at the table and eat food, why did I make the table?
There's no reason it should be there.
There's no reason it should be there. If I make a hat, and it's cold outside, but I'm like, you know, this hat is, I paid $5,000 for this hat, and I can't wear this hat in the elements. Why did I buy the hat? I'm going to go outside and freeze because the hat costs $5,000. It doesn't matter what the hat costs.
Put the hat on.
The hat is meant for me to put on.
And that's the thing. We gotta stop giving these material things value of life. They have no value. They are here for us to use as a resource, and that's it.
And that's it. They have no other purpose. You put money to them. Yeah. You add a price tag to them only because you are in the power to add a price tag to them.
That's it.
We can all go out there and make our own clothes. We can all grow our own food. We can do all those different things. But you have basically an industrial complex, and you're able to gather all these things because you have taken control of this certain region, or you have basically made an organization that says you have the right to this and you have a right to that. But I'm saying, by the end of the day, it has no value other than the value that you place on it. Your Jordans right now that you're wearing, you said you paid $500 for them.
They're just sneakers.
But it costs $10 to make. But you pay $5 for them, but they only cost $10 a make. They're only sneakers to ensure that the way that the earth is created, that your feet won't get infected. But there was times that we didn't wear shoes at all.
We didn't wear sneakers. Mm-hmm. That is
true. We didn't wear nothing.
You're not really supposed to wear sneakers, because when you don't wear sneakers, and say we was to walk outside barefoot, your feet will actually connect to the roots of the earth, because we are the earth. You know what I'm saying?
But we're the trees. We are walking trees in a sense.
The sneakers are actually blocking your electromagnetic field to connect to the soul.
That's correct. This is about emerging. That's basically like coming outside of these physiological comfort zones that we have created and tapping into our spiritual cortexes so we can align our chakras, you know what I'm saying, to the point where it would take us to new spaces. To higher plateaus and allow us to get to that ah moment. Like, whoa, that's what? oh, wow, that's amazing. This is what it's about, right? You know, you want to go on places where you can remove yourself from certain things, right? Where you can say, you know, this has no power over me. This has no value over me. I'm not going to allow this external situation to dominate my present existence, because my present existence is greater than this external factor, because this external factor had to come to me to affect me and to influence me to make me think that I need it in order to be able to exist, when I know that I do not need it in order to exist, because it would not have come to me to make me believe that it's supposed to exist, you know what I'm saying, according to my existence. I can say, you're not supposed to be here in the room with me. Why are you over here? What is wrong with you? Mm-hmm. Don't you see I'm busy living life? Why are you bringing these things into my space? Why are you bringing me despair, harm, anguish, frustration, hatred? You're not supposed to be in here. Leave. Get out of here, bro. Don't you see I'm over here chilling, bro? I'm about to eat my Fruity Pebbles, and I'm about to go about my business, right? This is basically taking control of your existence and understanding that I'm not controlled by any of these things that actually come into my existence to be at a point where I allow them to control me. I didn't create them. I'm not going to allow them to control me at the same time. And learning this lesson in real time and showing, like, listen, you know, I have the right to a free will to say what things I want in my life and what things I don't want in my life.
That is true.
You know what I'm saying? And not allow myself to be dominated by a world that existed before I came back on this plane, before I woke back up, right? It's going to be here when I'm born. That's right. When I don't respond to it, it's going to jump to the next person.
That's it.
Right? And that's what it's going to do. You know, like, I was on a train one time, about to leave, but I was on a train one time, and this big guy, was huge. I got on the train, I was with Cam, and he looked at me, and I said, why he projected spirit at me like that? So I just kept moving.
Yeah.
I sat down, he turned around at me, and he projected spirit again. And okay. I saw that he was looking for a confrontation. So what I did is, I said, I'm blocking my spirit. That's exactly what I said to myself. I said, I'm blocking my spirit from this entity, whatever his energy is. And that's what, when I said that, he turned around. And once he turned around, he started messing with three or four other people until one person responded to him.
And they got in a conflict.
And they got into a conflict. But he tried to bring the energy to me, but I blocked it because I said,
you're self-aware.
I don't want you here. I don't want you here, and I don't need you here. Right? And when we're looking into this world, we really don't see that we have the power to emerge. We have the power to come out of situations that we believe are dominant forces and they are not. We have the power to walk away from $50 million with only $10 in our pocket in order to save our lives. We have that power. It was one story, I don't know, I'm gonna find it for you, but it was a Twilight Zone. And it was the man did not like his life. He was like this low-level office manager. He had a wife and two daughters. He had a house, but he wanted to be infamous. He wanted to be famous.
Mm-hmm.
And a program had popped up and was like, you can exchange your life for somebody else's life that's wealthy. Wow. And they'll take your life and you'll take their life. So he did it. He found a rich man and they swapped. But he didn't know that the rich man, he was a multi-billionaire, but he didn't know that the rich man's wife was plotting to kill him.
Wow.
So when he swapped out, the rich man went to his family, and he went to the rich man's life, and the woman wound up taking his life. And then the rich man started over from scratch and took his life, but he still was in existence. And as he was realized that they poisoned him, he tried to get to the phone, because he had like 40 hours to cancel the contract, but they had poison him. And he tried to grab the phone so he could cancel it, but he couldn't get to the phone, you know what I'm saying? And that was all she wrote.
And we as people have to learn to appreciate life. What we have,
right.
Just be appreciative of what you have, because others are going through more, or other people might have more, but they might have more problems and issues.
They might have more problems and issues. That's right. And so this is it. You know, this is IAMTHEDATA. You know, we're talking about emerging you with my son, Quamel Evans, Daniel Evans. Subscribe, connect with us.
Definitely.
You know, it's all about emerging, man, and finding your true purpose in your life. Hold on for a second, son.